Okay, so the idea with this is let's make it as interactive as possible. And I don't have slides, I have a flip chart. I would like you to kind of, as I'm drawing these things and explaining it, tell me why it wouldn't work. Because this is not a fully baked idea. I'm here with a half-baked idea. I have some good results with that, but I have no idea where the limitations are. And like any other idea, it applies in some contexts, it does not apply in some other contexts, and then kind of I rely on you to, you know, either tell me now why it wouldn't work or try it and then see what the limitations are. I think the idea has a lot of potential. And if we kind of, as a community, evolve it over the next couple of years, we can make it into something really, really useful. So I got started on this path a couple of years ago when I invested a lot of my time into a startup where we thought we had one of the best development teams in the world. We're doing everything you hear about in terms of, you know, those far out blogs that talk about weird stuff, fast delivery and things like that. And we were very, very proud of what we were doing technically. And the company ran out of money. And kind of, I had to take a big, long look at the mirror. At the point, kind of, I came to the point where next month I wouldn't have enough money for rent. And I, you know, with a wife and two kids, I had to take a look at the mirror and say, well, we're not that good. If we, you know, if we ran out of money, there's no justification to say we're one of the best development teams in the world if we ran out of money. And that's when I realized that there's really another complete feedback loop missing from a lot of what we do in delivery. And I was the CTO of this startup, and you know, it was all very friendly and things like that, but we have huge problems explaining to other investors why certain things shouldn't be done for the seventh time because there's nothing happening and we're wasting time and money doing this. And I started looking for kind of models that people used to do that successfully, and not just in software but in other areas as well. And I found some really nice ideas, for example, in what people have done for organizing communities in the 60s, and what some people have done to prevent large organizations from wasting a horrible amount of money on training programs in the 80s, and things like that. So kind of, I took some interesting ideas out of those, and then we kind of joined them together, tried them in a couple of places, and out came this kind of idea to map out impact. The critical assumption I have, which again, I've not done a big wide industry research, it's just based on a couple of projects I've worked with, a couple of clients I've worked with recently, is that the bottleneck has moved. 10 years ago, the bottleneck for many teams was in delivery. People were just not shipping things out. Then, kind of with the whole kind of Scrum thing and XP, people started shipping things out. So the bottleneck then moved, and it moved a bit to kind of requirements and a bit to testing. And for a lot of teams, the bottleneck was in testing. Now that bottleneck has moved as well. As a community, we've learned how to do testing better. We've learned how to do requirements better as well. Then over the last 2 or 3 years, most of the buzz was around operations. And kind of the key buzzword was you know, DevOps and integrating operations, you know, continuous delivery. I think, you know, the bottleneck is moving again. And I think the bottleneck is slowly moving out of the realm of IT. That's really interesting. Because now many teams I work with are able to ship stuff. The question is, are we shipping the right thing? And how do we know that we are actually shipping the right thing? Or how do we prove that we are not shipping the right thing? And this is where kind of one of the really interesting things I've seen, and a lot of my clients are relatively big banks. And kind of when you look at a typical project that's done there, it's very difficult to determine what this thing was really supposed to achieve from a business objective. It's very difficult to determine whether this thing was a business success or not, because lots of people want different things, and just kind of comes together And out comes this software that kind of we measure on some technical tests, we measure on, you know, performance tests, we measure very rarely on usability, but sometimes yes, but and kind of there's no measurement of business success. There's no closing the feedback loop, was this the right thing to do at all? I worked with one of the biggest media companies in London, and they were trying to optimize a 4-week testing cycle. And they wanted to have a 3-week delivery cycle. So mathematically, you can't fit 4 weeks of testing into a 3-week delivery cycle. So something had to give. And we were talking about, you know, where do we start? They wanted automation. That was their solution. Kind of where do we start automating? And, you know, what do we automate? And they had about 15 years of legacy tests that nobody understood. And nobody knew whether these things were really kind of useful for anything or not. And I was trying to kind of convince them that even those things that they do, who knows whether, you know, that we're doing the right things or not. And we ended up discussing multiple phases of software quality, which was really, really interesting. And we tried to draw parallels between the Maslow model of human needs and kind of the software quality, because you know, we're trying to reduce the number of bugs and things like that all the time, but somebody made the joke that that's like people trying to make money, but they're not being happy when they make money. And likewise, these guys were trying to reduce bugs, but then they were still not happy when they reduced bugs. And the Maslow model is kind of a very simplified version of the explanation of this research, was that, as I said, Maslow was trying to understand why people struggle to make money all their life, but when they do, they're not happy. And he said that kind of there are multiple phases of kind of multiple levels of human needs. And he said on the bottom level of the pyramid, we have physiological needs. So these are air, water, and kind of I need enough air to breathe. I need water, otherwise I will not survive for long. But he said, kind of, enough is enough here. And more air than I need is not increasing my quality of life. More water than I need is a flood that's kind of damaging my quality of life. And kind of on top of that, he said, once you have enough physiological needs, kind of, there are some safety needs. So safety needs are physical security, financial security, and things like that. But then again, he said, kind of, at this level, again, enough is enough. So, kind of, you know, more security than I need is not necessarily good. Look at airports these days and things like that. So then, kind of, he said on top of that, there's kind of love and belonging. And on top of that, he said, once you have enough love and belonging, what you're looking for is self-esteem. And then on top of that, there's self-actualization. Now, this model, like any other model, is wrong because it's an abstraction, but it might be useful for certain things. And what was useful here was trying to explain that the things on the bottom are more important than the things on the top if they are missing. If I do not have enough water, I'm not going to care too much about self-actualization. That goes out of the window immediately. At the same time, he said that once you start satisfying the things on the bottom, in order to really improve your quality of life, you need to get these things on the top more satisfied. So kind of enough is enough on the things on the bottom. So we started kind of trying to translate this thing in software. And we said, kind of on the bottom level, what would be the physiological needs of our software? So the model we came up with, I've no statistical relevance to the entire industry. It applied to one client. It might or might not be applied to you. It might need to change for your situation. So if you think it's wrong, it probably is, but it applied to this client. So I'll tell you how we got there, and then you can see how you would modify it for your situation. So the physiological needs of our software is it has to be deployable. If it is not deployable, it doesn't matter. Kind of. So it needs to be deployable. And we said it needs to be functionally okay. So functionally okay was here as well. So If it doesn't have enough features, if it's not functioning okay, kind of nothing else matters really. But at the same time, enough is enough. So these guys wanted to deploy every 3 weeks. Making the software deployable every 20 minutes was irrelevant. That was overinvestment in deployment. At the same time, kind of, we started looking at functionality as well, kind of how much we test, how much we put in, from the same perspective. And really, a lot of the projects I've worked on just have too much functionality that's not really needed there. An example I like to use is, I've not really worked on this piece of software, but I work with it, is Microsoft Word. It's like over the last 10 years, it's gotten 10,000 new features that nobody uses. And it has this ribbon thing on top that makes me not know how to print documents anymore, and I feel really stupid. So more functionality is not necessarily good. Then we said, okay, what is the, you know, the safety thing? We said, well, security, obviously, and performance and things like that. So this thing is works, then it kind of works well. So say security, performance, and things like that. Again, and this is where enough is enough. So with this startup in particular, we've over-invested in performance. We've built the system to be much, much, much more performant than they actually had customers. And going back now, I would kind of stop optimizing it for performance 6 months before we stopped. And I would spend those 6 months doing some other things. And then kind of we said, okay, on top of this, we kind of have love and belonging in the Maslow model. And this is kind of relates nicely to usability. Because that's where you get kind of, you know, love and belonging for your customers. And kind of this started kind of explaining what these guys were doing wrong with testing. Because most of their testing, most of their development was in this area here. And so maybe, you know, we're overdoing it. Maybe we're good enough here, we should really be starting to look at some other things as well there. And again, a lot of teams do their kind of investment in functionality, invest in performance, security, invest in usability, both from a requirements, delivery, and testing perspective. But kind of there are two more levels here. And we you know, the I think as teams, this is kind of my key lesson. As teams, we declare victory too early. We kind of get here and we declare victory. Now, does anybody know what Nokia Ovi is? How many people know what Nokia Ovi is? Two, three. Okay. So for the rest of you, Nokia Ovi was a business re-engineering effort. Started in 2007. Where at this point, Nokia was on top of the world. They were number one in everything, and they started transitioning from being a mobile phone manufacturer to being a service provider. They started using design thinking Tim Brown, who was, he's the leader of the IDEO, famous design agency, initiator of design thinking. Kind of, he worked with them, and his book on design thinking, the seminal book on design thinking called Change by Design, came out in 2009. So I assume it was kind of finished around 2008, about a year after this whole thing started. And there he declares victory for Nokia Ovi. There's a very strong sentence in the book where he says that barely a year after the transition started, Nokia is no longer a hardware manufacturer. They are now a service provider, and they've re-engineered the whole business, and it's a fantastic success of design thinking. It's brilliant. And kind of the history will remember Ovi differently, or probably not remember it at all. The coverage of Ovi on the register is brilliant. If you read the register, you know, go and Google for Ovi, because these guys saw what's going to happen years before everybody else. And they had a fantastic article in 2010 where kind of, at this point, Apple took over the world, and Nokia's service, although it was usable and brilliant and already victorious, nobody was using it. And they were struggling to kind of, you know, get a hold in the service market, and still not really listening to any feedback from the market. They bet the whole company on this and started rebranding other services of it. And there was an article in the Register that basically starts like something, oh, people are going to ask, what is Nokia? Is Nokia a new type of yoga or some kind of a vegetarian diet? No, this is the company that produces the highly successful Ovi brand that nobody knows about. And kind of the, in 2011, Ovi was finally killed with kind of basically Nokia transforming from a market leader to an also-ran. And Google and Apple now completely owning the mobile phone market. These guys declared victory too early. What I think they were missing is the next level there. And this is where the software might be usable. There might be fantastic potential for usability there. But it might not actually be used. So is it useful? Is a very interesting question. Is anybody actually using this? Do we have enough people that are using this thing for what we wanted to do? And then kind of the real question becomes, can we really declare victory at this level? Or do we need feedback about this level as well? Should we invest in terms of requirements, in terms of delivery, in terms of testing on this level as well? And I'll give you another example. One of my clients, wanted, again, I do get a lot of calls to help people with testing. They wanted to kind of automate their entire kind of testing suite, which had I don't know how many thousands of manual tests. And I gave them a challenge of actually, before you rewrite all your tests, go and measure what percentage of your system is actually being used. Because this was a system that was built over 15 years of legacy stuff. People's assumptions have changed. The market opportunities have changed. You know, I don't know enough about the system, but are you sure that everything that's tested is still being used? And again, this is quite an extreme case. I don't expect everybody to be in this position, but when 3 months later, they came back with a figure of 70% of the system not being used. And then at this point, rewriting those tests, maintaining the software is a waste of money and time. So, there's one more level of the Maslow pyramid, and this got us thinking about, well, you know, what else is there? And does anybody remember the Hoover free flights promotion? Yeah. Okay, so some people in the room don't know about this at all. So Hoover, the vacuum cleaner manufacturer, they wanted to clear up their inventory in, I think, 1991. And what they did is they came up with this thing that is remembered in the history as the worst marketing campaign ever. Because they promised that if you buy $100 worth of their equipment, they will give you 2 return flight tickets. And with the demand on the travel agents being overwhelming, and they expanded that to include intercontinental flights as well. Now, it doesn't take a math genius to work out that people were soon buying $100 of Hoover equipment to throw it away and get a intercontinental flight. And what happened is, kind of, they got to something that was really useful. People were using it. But the company ended up, I think, closing the UK department, selling the European department to Candy, ended up with about a £50 million loss and having to kind of be dragged through court cases for about 6-7 years with disgruntled customers. So as a marketing campaign, this was horrible. They got to something that people actually used, but it wasn't successful. So kind of we said, you know, the self-actualization is for this thing to be successful on top. So and then we started thinking about, well, we can't really declare victory until we get to this point. But we're not really testing for this point, these two things at all. We are ignoring this thing completely in our cycle. This is kind of outside of the realm of what we do. In terms of requirements management, people talk to some business people somewhere without really understanding how is this going to be useful and how do we measure business success. And this kind of, you know, really got me start thinking about, well, how would we actually capture this information? Where do we, who do we chase about this? You know, where do we find this thing? And since I started trying to do this, I realized that in lots of companies, there's no agreement on these things at all. Different business people have completely different opinion of these things. And from a kind of theoretical perspective, unless we get them to agree on this, the success of a project or a product is just random. So we kind of, another thing that I've looked at is this research and a method that a guy called Robert Blinkenhoff developed in the 80s to prevent organizations from wasting a lot of money on training programs. He said lots of big companies just kind of overinvest in training that doesn't really deliver any big change. And he said the way we're testing the success of training programs is wrong because we're declaring victory too early. Again, kind of similar thing. And he says we declare victory with people kind of filling in a feedback form that says, yes, I enjoyed the training. Or, you know, this will impact my performance at work. And fantastic, yes. And he said, well, you shouldn't do that. He said, what he suggested is figure out the change you want to create in the way people do work. Then get some training in, and then measure whether that change happened or not. It doesn't matter if people found this enjoyable, was it actually useful? And then he said, does that change, you know, first of all, have you achieved the change in the people that work? And then does that change in the way the people work contribute to your business vision? If not, don't call these people to train you again. If yes, call them to run the training. And he started kind of thinking, one of the really profound things I've heard there, I've read in the book, is that the work itself that people do is irrelevant for this thing. What's relevant is the change in that work. So translated to agile requirement stuff, user stories, for example. Typical user story says something like, as a, let's say, settlement top user, in order to process trade exceptions, I want this report. So translated to software, what Brinkhoff says is this thing is irrelevant. What's relevant is what kind of change in this thing do you want to create? I want to process trade exceptions faster, more accurately. What is the change you want to create? And then since I started asking people about what is the change in this, some very interesting things started happening because we actually figured out a way how to measure this. If you say, in order to process trade exceptions, the only question you can ask is, are you processing trade exceptions? Yes, I am, that's my job. Hey, brilliant, victory. Where if we say faster, kind of the fact that we're discussing a change opens up a natural discussion, oh, well, how faster is faster? What are you doing now? And we can actually measure whether this user story delivered faster exception processing or not. And if not, then you know, it could have passed all those tests on these levels there, but if people are not using it to process trade exceptions, then we failed there. If kind of it's not bringing any business benefit there, we failed on this level. So it kind of starts opening up a discussion of how we're doing these things. And then kind of another really interesting thing hit me is that all software is really based on assumptions. Somebody gave us this user story because they thought this is going to allow people to process it faster. But the organizations are so complex, it has so many kind of parts that are interconnected, that the fact that you do this thing might prevent people from actually somewhere else in the organization might prevent people from actually processing exceptions faster. Because this is incomplete, this is irrelevant. So, this thing then allows us to actually measure for usefulness. But then again, it doesn't help us measure for success. They can still process exceptions faster, but how is this contributing to the vision? So Brinkhoff says, you know, go and ask, how does this contribute to the vision? We can say, well, because this allows us to reduce the cost of transactions. And then we can actually see if processing exception faster reduces the cost of transactions or not. Maybe there's another blockage in the company that doesn't do that. So kind of Brinkhoff's idea, and he has an incredibly complex visualization. So incredibly complex, is to kind of figure out what are the underlying assumptions about usefulness and about success. And then visualize that, get different people in the company to agree on these things up front. And kind of essentially what he's doing is bring test-driven development ideas to these two things and run them through organizations. And kind of another thing that I found that was really interesting is a Swedish interaction design agency that tried to explain to work with the Swedish government to kind of show how their projects and why their projects are running over budget and over kind of time. And they use this visualization to kind of prevent scope creep. That had some very, very similar things to this. They used a mind map that started with the question, why are we doing this? Kind of at the business success level. And then they had a, well, who are the users of our software? Who needs our software? So, and then they said, well, you know, what do these people need? And then they said, well, how can we help them get to this? And what's really amazing about this visualization is it's simple and it visualizes these two assumptions. Lots of requirements collection methods we do, requirements engineering methods, communication methods for requirements we do not communicate those two assumptions. They communicate what we need to do. And kind of some other kind of levels there, but they don't really communicate these assumptions. And what we have here is that this is a software deliverable. If we deliver this software here, the connections in this mind map are assumptions. If we deliver something here, we assume that it is going to fulfill some user need. And we assume that fulfilling some user need is going to contribute to a business goal. Now, tying these two things together, Brinkhoff and this thing, so this is called effect mapping from in-use. And the agency is in-use. Tying these two things, what I've realized is that this level here is a bit wrong. Or at least for the kind of projects that I was involved in, this level here is a bit wrong. Because all my business users always wanted to become rich and live in the Caribbean. But that's not part of my project, really. So capturing all my user needs is kind of what people typically suffer from with user stories, just a bunch of scope creep. And we said, let's not talk about what they need. Let's apply Brinkhoff's idea. Let's do the kind of business behavior change, work change there. And we started asking this question not in terms of what they need. We started asking the question, how does their behavior change as a result of our software? How should it change? And then kind of in order not to keep how, we rephrase this question to what? And we said, what can we do to help this? What can we deliver to kind of support this change? Now, kind of this visualization starts to kind of now, as it visualize these assumptions, it starts allowing us to communicate this, and from my experience, gets business people to start agreeing on what they really want. And narrowing down what is it that they actually want. So one really interesting thing is that if you have something like this, and you work back to kind of this thing really and figure out how to measure it, scope creep will visually not fit in. For example, a user story that says, well, you know, I want to have this button that does something for me, if it doesn't really contribute to any behavioral change that you want to create, you will not be able to fit it in. And I've by reverse engineering some backlogs for projects that were planned already and approved and everything, we've been able to eliminate, say, 70 to 80% of a project. Because once I got people to agree on this thing, a lot of stuff didn't really map to that. It mapped to some other things that other people wanted. Now, the kind of very interesting thing tying this with Agile is that if we deliver incrementally, we can focus on one business goal at a time. and we can narrow things down to satisfy that business goal. And what kind of, I'll give you an example of what I did with a games company. So we, this is a company that produces video games for Facebook. And the owner of the company came in one day and said, the next thing we want to do are levels and achievements for all our games. Now this is 7 to 9 months of work. And it's a deliverable, it's a what. So we said, let's visualize the assumptions you have behind that so we can figure out what's going on there. And we said, levels and achievements. And sorry about my handwriting. So that's a what. Now, the next question is, how does this change somebody's behavior? And he said, what do you mean? I said, well, you know, we deliver 9 months of work for you. And if it doesn't change anything, then this is a horrible waste of time. Now, how does this change somebody's behavior? And he said, well, people will be able to get levels and achievements. But that's not behavior. That's, you know, where is the behavioral change there? And he said, well, okay, so people will be able to post more frequently about these things. I said, okay, so they can't post about our games at the moment, or they're not posting frequently enough. What we want to get them to do is post more frequently. Having levels and achievements where kind of you achieve something or you receive another level is going to prompt you to post it to Facebook. So, okay, so posting more frequently. That is a behavioral change. And then we can deliver something here, we can measure whether people are actually posting more frequently. Now we said, okay, we know that kind of who, those are the players. And the question is then why? Why do you want people to post more frequently? How does this contribute to any kind of business goal? He said, well, if people post more frequently, other people will read about this. So Chris Mutz, who invented feature injection that kind of is going in the same direction, says, keep asking why until you get to the money. That's kind of, for commercial organizations, a good idea to try. He said, you know, reading about postings doesn't really bring us any money. Why is that important? He said, well, if they read about this, maybe they will come and play our games. Okay, why is that important? He said, well, that's a stupid question. Because more players is kind of more money. We know that the player is worth about $100 over a lifetime. So okay, so what you want is more players there. So we have visualized two levels of assumptions. One level of assumption is that if we deliver levels of achievements, people will post more frequently. Another thing is that if they post more frequently, we will actually get more players. Now, this starts becoming the backbone of what we want to do. But what's really also interesting is that this thing is really my key deliverable. If I can deliver this faster, cheaper, if I can deliver this without software, if I can deliver this kind of better than this, I should do that. And now kind of we start again, you know, this knowledge exists in companies, it's just not communicated. So we start thinking about, okay, this is 7 months of work. It's quite a big assumption. Can we prove that this thing actually makes sense, somehow cheaper? And then if we've proven that this thing makes sense, let's go and do this. And one guy said, well, we have tournaments. People win a tour, one person wins a tournament every day. Maybe we can just pop up a dialogue saying, post to Facebook that you won a tournament. If nobody ever clicks that, we know that people are unlikely to post because we have a bad brand, because we have lots of different things. But if they click on that and nobody ever comes, we know that posting is not going to give us more players. If they click on that and people come, we have proven this assumption. So, tournament ending is one way to prove this assumption. And we said, okay, you know, if players can help us achieve this by posting, and we're already starting to do analysis. That's why I like the design thinking idea about analysis. Design thinking says that people often analyze by choosing one option and then analyzing that. And that's not true analysis. You can only analyze if you have multiple options. She said, let's create some other options. Let's expand this map on all of these levels. And that's why the map has an interesting structure. So we said, how else could you get to 1 million players? First of all, we started thinking about, okay, how much more is more? And then we defined this as 1 million over 6 months. And then we said, how else? And then the marketing guy said, well, if 1 million is what you want to get, I know that by putting adverts on Google, on Facebook, I can buy a player for about $4. So give me $4 million, I give you 1 million players. And we have advertisers here, we have some other options. And from that point on, the goal of software starts being, can we actually deliver this in less than 4 million? If not, we should buy that and not build software, not have to maintain it, not have to do other things. And we said, okay, let's build them up elsewhere. So, you know, are there other ways for players to, you know, if we change players' behavior to contribute to this? He said, well, maybe they can invite friends. Maybe they can do some other things. And this is where I realized another really interesting thing is that business people are much more likely to have a good opinion about this level than this level here. If you ask people, do you expect that inviting friends is going to get you faster to 1 million players than posting or not, they will be able to kind of compare those things mentally much better. So I have another trick with this. I carry around lots of fake money with me all the time. You can get Monopoly money or kind of play money, because there's a lot of research that shows that if you give people money, another part of the brain turns on. So I carry around a lot of fake money with me, and then I tell them, okay, buy this stuff. We get five business people in the room, give them some money and say, buy it. And in this case, everybody started buying invitations. And we said, why is this happening? And they said, well, invitations are viral, of course. If I'm going to put money, I'm going to put it into this. But then put your people's time into this as well. Why are you putting your people's time into this? And we started thinking about talking invitations. That's, again, an interesting assumption. If we allow people to invite friends, we will get more players. Now let's test that assumption. And we said, we could do lots of different things about invitations, but the question is, how do you prove that this assumption was correct? That this is a successful thing? And somebody says, well, you know, I can put a button on there that says, you know, invite friends. If nobody ever clicks on that button, we know this is wrong. If people click on it and we send out invitations and the other players don't come because, I don't know, you know, we get caught in spam filters or whatever, this is a wrong idea. So we can actually slice this and test it through the whole pyramid. And that's what we did. We put a button there that says invite friends. It did nothing. It just dumped people's email addresses. And, you know, you click on it, it takes your friends' email addresses and it dumps it into a file. We stayed overnight to send some emails manually. And we kind of measured that, yes, people click on invite friends, but no, players are not coming. And we went to the marketing guy and said, sorry, not a good idea. He said, no, it has to be a good idea. I said, well, here's the data. And he said, no, something's wrong. The email template is wrong. I said, okay, let's change the email template. And we said, you know, this thing was, you know, we got to the point where it was usable, useful, no success. So I'm not going to continue building software for that. So we said, give me another email template and let's test that. And again, we kept the button there. We stayed another night, sent another couple of hundred emails manually, and got people responding. And we said, hey, this is going in the right direction. So then we started kind of expanding this, adding more user stories there. User stories kind of either here or even deeper. And we started adding more user stories. And at the point where we ticked off the first couple of items here, we got there. And we said, stop. You wanted 1 million players, you got 1 million players. I'm not going to waste 7 months of my life building this. Because this is what you wanted. So what next? And the visual aspect of this allowed us to capture these assumptions. It allowed us to get people to agree on this. And it allowed us to actually kind of test those two upper levels as we're delivering. So we kind of closed the loop with the business very easily. So I get a lot of people complaining that their typical user story is not going to create any big business change. But that's because we don't do it by design. It's the same thing with TDD and unit testing. If you are designing your system to be testable up front, you will build in testing hooks. You will slice it in a way that makes it testable. If you're not doing it that way, TDD can be impossible. And in the same way, if we are thinking about, well, everything we do has to actually cause a business change, then we will slice the system to be able to do it. We will find ways of doing that, because this is what we're trying to cause, not this. The purpose of delivery for me is getting here. If I don't get there, it doesn't matter. Everything I've done just doesn't matter. So, kind of, this visualization, we started actually doing it now by growing it up to the third level, getting business people to put money into the top third level thing, and then getting some options for the fourth level to actually start proving that these things work. And if the thing is too big, then we say, okay, how do we move this at least a bit? How do we learn that this thing was a good idea to do? And we started kind of running cycles by expanding this map, adding a few items there, delivering, measuring, then moving to another direction. And there's a couple of really interesting things that this now allows us to do as a concept. Because as soon as you kind of start telling people that we're not going to kind of focus on delivering software, we're going to focus on delivering this thing, the first question they will ask is, okay, how much is it going to cost and where is it going to be delivered? And if you don't have scope that's preset, that's a really difficult question to ask. Even if you have scope that's preset, it's a very difficult question to answer. But we started positioning it like this. So nobody buys anything apart from software like that. If you buy a house, you don't ask yourself, well, how much is a house going to cost and when can I get it? If you go into a car shop, you don't say, hey, I would like to buy a car, how much does it cost and when can I get it? What we do is we have a budget in mind, and we have some critical things we need in mind, and we know when we need to buy, how much we can allow for that, and then we try to get the best possible option out. So with this particular thing, going back to this idea, we said, okay, how much is it going to cost? But we said, if it costs more than 4 million, it doesn't make sense, because then let's just go this branch and buy it. So it's less than 4 million. Now the question is how much less? Software is risky. You know, if we say if it's less than 2 million, but we go a budget, you know, how much less is less? How much is this thing worth? And when do you need it? And let's figure out, not kind of, you know, just budgeting it completely, but let's say, you know, 1 million players, we know kind of, let's say 1 million is the budget we have. Otherwise it doesn't make sense, because we might as well buy it and do something else. So 1 million is a budget. Well, how much time are we allowed to do for 1 million pounds? And let's not spend it all. Let's take a small percentage of that, put it somewhere here or somewhere there, and then see if these assumptions are correct. If they are correct, let's keep investing in that part of the map. If they're not correct, let's find another part of the map, put some money there, try to see if that assumption is correct or not. And kind of by that way, we are going to drive towards this goal. If we end up driving in the wrong direction, if we deliver something but it's not bringing this, we'll stop what we're doing and we'll drive somewhere closer. And another thing that this kind of solves is, again, scope creep. You can't really put a user story in that doesn't belong in here, because it doesn't belong here because you can see a user story like this, kind of forming on the map. We have, as a player, in order to invite more friends, I want these things. So a user story is going to map to this or not belong to this milestone, belong to something else. Again, Chris Mutz says, never say no, because people get pissed off, say not now. Kind of, this is our first milestone. The thing you want to do doesn't belong to that milestone. Let's postpone it until we achieve this thing first. So the other thing that's really interesting is this helps immensely with reprioritization. First of all, it allowed me to work with companies where we really do not grow it beyond level 3. And then for the top level 3, we grow it for kind of other things. And then if you prove that this assumption is wrong, maybe it was originally okay, but with the time given to deliver this, the market opportunity has changed, we prove that this is wrong, we can just stop doing anything in this end and expand another end of the map. And even if you end up reverse engineering a large project and kind of collapsing it into a map that's big, you can still reprioritize relatively easily, because what I realized is real business prioritization happens on this level here. Is posting more important than inviting? Which one do you want to support? What is the business behavior change we want to create? That's the prioritization thing. Prioritizing user stories is irrelevant. What we need to prioritize is this thing here, because that's what the business impact is. So kind of that's the overall idea of impact mapping. So when we visualize these things are business goals, These teams are actors or stakeholders. These teams here are impacts on actor behavior. I like calling these things impacts because an impact is a change. When you talk about the behavior, you talk about, well, you know, I trade, I do this, I do that, and then people come up with user stories that are, as a trader, in order to trade, I want to trade, which is insane. But there's no way of explaining why this is insane. When we talk about impacts on somebody's behavior, you need to define a change. And these guys here are deliverables or kind of user stories or use cases or whatever you want to create. And kind of the interesting thing about this, and this is not the only model, there are plenty of other models, especially in academia, to kind of try to capture this. It's simple. There's four questions you need to ask, people remember it. You go in, you go out, people remember it, they keep doing it. I mean, Tom Gilb, of course, invented everything 30 years ago, as I'm sure you know. And for many things it is true. So he wrote about all this, but he ends up putting it into tables that are kind of a bit bureaucratic. People don't remember how to do them right. This thing is nice and visual. It kind of does what David Sibet says in visual meetings, where kind of visualizing things gives you another 80 IQ points. It kind of helps people agree on these things. And also because you know, it's a map, so it's dynamic. We can start shrinking it, we can start growing it, we can move around this map. I found it really, really useful for kind of driving these two things here, because we start visualizing them and communicating them. And then we can build our systems to be testable in that way from the start. And we can navigate towards these things here. So I'll leave you kind of before we. I was hoping that somebody's going to interrupt me and you know ask questions, but I'll leave you with the thought that what we're really missing is a GPS navigator for our software, because what we lack now is, you know, everybody measures velocity, but velocity is like kilometers per hour. It's good that you're driving at high speed, but if you're going the wrong direction, doesn't matter. Kind of velocity, if velocity is, you know, 1 kilometer per hour, you know something's wrong. But what we're lacking is distance to destination. And what we're lacking is the distance to the next turn that the GPS navigator is telling me, and expected time of arrival. And kind of, this is my next turn. This behavior change that I want to create. This is my next turn on the map. And I can measure whether I've made that turn or not. And this thing is my destination. And I can measure my distance to destination with everything I do. Am I going in the right direction or not? So as a visualization, it's a relatively simple idea to explain. That's why I love it. And it helped me avoid the problem of kind of redoing things 7 times and not being able to communicate to business people why this is the wrong thing to do. That's where I am with this at the moment. Now, why doesn't this work for your company?
So that's a lovely example, but it's from a naturally fast feedback environment.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're building a commercial software package to mm-hmm. sell to a bank, who maybe take one release a year if you're lucky, and then take a year to implement mm-hmm. it, that
again. So I agree with you, and that's a limitation.